This is the show where NFL legends come to tell their stories. This is the show where we spotlight what's good in the world of sports. This is also the show where we appreciate the NFL Alumni Association and the Gridiron Greats. For this is Thursday Night Tailgate with your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, it's finally tonight. I've waited all day. Have a good time and take it away.
Lord, I've been waiting all day for tonight as well. Good evening, folks, and thank you for coming back and joining us on Thursday Night Tailgate, where your favorite NFL legends live. You got Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari here to help get you ready for Week 15 in the NFL. Plus, we're going to give you some great interviews with some of the game's greatest legends, plus our good friend and former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. He'll join us for our five-star picks of the week, and then we'll wrap the show up like we do every week with probably our favorite segment of the show, and that's our Spotlight on the Positive, where we'll share two more great stories with you about players doing great things out there in their community. So a lot on tap for you tonight, but we kick things off with my co-host, Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend?
Hey, Chris. Happy Thursday. How are you?
Thank you. I'm fantastic. As we were just talking about a moment ago off air, we want to send out a hearty congratulations to our good friend Jen Welter on her job with the Atlanta Legends. She's going to be a defensive assistant for that team in the American Alliance of Football, which will kick off in February, the week right after the Super Bowl. But Jen's a great girl, been a great friend for a long time, going all the way back to her time as a player in the Women's League for the Dallas Diamonds and then Team USA. But a wonderful friend of the show and a great job for a great gal, Bob.
Yeah, we know she had the opportunity in Arizona, which was great, Chris. And you're right. I mean, we were talking to her when she was still playing, and I like to think that we had something to do, at least her getting her name out there. And I think we accomplished it, and no one more deserving than her. Congratulations.
Yeah, absolutely. No, there's not anybody more deserving than her. A great football player, great football mind, and now she gets an opportunity to continue what she started when she was an intern, to your point, Bob, with the Arizona Cardinals. So she's here in town with the Atlanta Legends and look forward to watching her success, as that league grows, and so does her resume. Bob, I also wanted to get some quick thoughts from you. We learned today that Carson Wentz has a fractured vertebrae in his back, and it's not going to require surgery, but it's looking like he's done for the rest of the season. So, Bob, I wanted to get your thoughts. You know, if Nick Foles comes in and was somehow able to lead the Eagles to wins in their last three games, it's not going to be easy because they got the Rams, Texans, and the Redskins to get through. But even at 6-7, they're only half a game out of the last playoff spot right now. So if he were able to get that job done, are we going to end up with a quarterback controversy in Philadelphia?
You know, we thought that was going to be the case after the Super Bowl last year, Chris, and first of all, I've been reading about it throughout the week, and just the whole thing about he hasn't been himself. And now we're hearing, it was bizarre to me, Chris, that they've been doing this testing for a while now, and it just shows up. You know, it seemed like, unless it got totally worse as time went on and it finally started to show on it, it just seemed to me kind of bizarre how it didn't really, they didn't have a good picture of this sooner. But again, if you're a Philly fan, think about this. You have a Super Bowl MVP as your backup. You're paying the guy about $6 million a year. And as you know, Chris, he actually started as their quarterback this year. First two games, completed 66% of his passes. This guy's he's an established quarterback, Chris. You remember him back in 2013. That year he had 27 TDs and two picks. This guy can win. He can throw. He can play. He's a big dude. And perhaps the time that he hasn't spent on the gridiron as a backup, Chris, is probably benefited him. His body's probably in good shape right now. So I don't think there's any quarterback that a team would be more happier than this guy, Chris. I mean, especially, you said big games. I mean, he played in the biggest and came through. And if he does well, like you said, I still think, you know, it's Carson Wentz's team, but there is no, I don't think any Philly fans out there are worried about Foles. And right now, it's almost like a wash. You know, you have an injured Wentz or a healthy Foles. I'm going with Nick Foles.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think they're going to miss a beat, and it's going to be interesting to see what he can do and if he's got a little bit of fire at the end of the season and they were somehow to beat the Rams, Texans, and Redskins. Boy, that's another huge feather in his cap. Not as big as, to your point a moment ago, Bob, not as big as being the Super Bowl MVP, but just something to add to his already growing resume. So looking forward to seeing how he does. And folks, as we look at the rest of the night, who do we have set for you tonight? Who's going to be joining us? Well, we've got former Falcons running back Lynn Cain, and Lynn had joined us a couple of months ago, and we really enjoyed the time we got to spend with him, wanted to get him back on the show as quickly as we could, and he's going to be here tonight. We'll get his thoughts on his alma mater, USC, who had an un-Trojan-like season, finishing 5-7 this year, so they're not going to be playing in a bowl. We'll talk about that. Also get his thoughts on the Falcons season, which also didn't live up to expectations, but Bob, Lynn was an underrated running back, not here in Atlanta. People still talk about him, still loved him for his time with the Falcons, but a guy that got it done and a very talented running back.
Agree, Chris. I remember him well. And 914 yards rushing in 1980 for Lehman Bennett's Falcon team. And he also caught 55 passes the following year. So this guy was a very versatile back and actually ended his career in 85 with the Rams, Chris. So, but we're glad to have him back.
Yes, we are. Following him, we'll get our normal visit from former Patriots running back Tony Collins to go through our five-star picks of the week for Week 15 in the NFL. He'll join us at the bottom of this half hour. Following Tony, we'll get a visit from former Saints, Chargers, and Lions defensive back Alex Molden. Alex is a guy who's a former first-round draft pick, the 11th overall selection in the draft. So a guy very talented coming out of the University of Oregon, a guy who completely tore up his knee. And when I say completely tore up, ACL, MCL, PCL, all gone in a terrible injury. But rehabbed his way back, Bob. Only took him 10 months to get completely healthy and back out on the field. So really looking forward to hearing about that dedication that it took to get himself back. And like I say, you know, a guy who became then an All-American, a guy who became a first-round pick, the 11th pick in the draft in 1996. Played 8 years in the league, so really looking forward to having Alex on the show.
Yeah, great to have him on the show. 8-year veteran, Chris, made a dozen picks for the Saints and Chargers, and actually went to the same high school as former Steelers defensive end Aaron Smith, who you remember well. So great to have him on the show, and welcome, Alex.
Yeah, we look forward to him. He'll be here about 45 minutes from now. We'll kick off hour number two with a return visit from former Vikings Pro Bowl defensive tackle Keith Millard. Keith has become a really great friend of the show. And Bob, Keith and I were talking yesterday, and he's got his eyes on Aaron Donald, who is threatening to break Keith's record for the most sacks in the season by a defensive tackle. Keith had 18 back in 1989. Aaron Donald's got 16.5 going into this week. So we'll hear if Keith is rooting for or against Donald to break the record, plus get his thoughts on the Vikings this season. So looking forward to having Keith back.
Yeah, great guest, great friend, Chris, Pro Bowler, Defensive Player of the Year. What a resume. And anyone that remembers the guy that wore number 75 in Minnesota, and you know we have a lot of friends of ours who love this guy, and they yell out, skull, skull, during the show. So we're happy to have him. Keith is great. I mean, his insight's terrific, and can't wait to speak with him again.
And then we'll round out tonight's show talking with Don Beebe, and we had Don on the show over the summer. Had a lot of fun when he joined us. And speaking of the Vikings, Don's son Chad is a wide receiver on their roster right now. So we'll talk about that. Plus get Don's thoughts on the Bills and the nuances of catching passes from Jim Kelly and then over to Brett Favre over the course of his career. Got to have two Hall of Famers throwing him balls, Bob. Had to be a thrill to be able to say, hey, I caught passes from him and him.
Yeah, that's major quarterbacks there. One of Kelly's old targets up in Buffalo in the snow. I remember it well. Over 3,400 yards over 9 seasons, Chris, was always known on both teams as the hardest worker out there. You know, I wouldn't say overachieved, but just was one of those hard-nosed guys. And had his best game as a Packer in 96, which I'll talk to him about because a friend of mine, big Packer fan, wanted to know his memories of that. So, Don's great guest. We'll love to talk to him.
Yeah, he'll be along about 90 minutes from now. So we got an exciting show on tap for you tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. So you know what? Sit back, relax. Let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life over the next couple of hours. And folks, as you know, we are brought to you by the great folks at the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. The Salt Creek Golf Retreat up in beautiful Nashville, Indiana. Our partners at the NFL Alumni Association and Mike Ditka's organization, the Gridiron Greats. Please go online and check them out at gridirongreats.org. Also, check out former Houston Oilers quarterback Dan Pastorini and his company, DP Quality Foods. Dan has a lineup of award-winning spices that you're really going to love. Go online to dpqualityfoods.com to check them out.
It's time for another edition of Bob Take. So, Bob, tell us, what's on your mind tonight?
All right, let's get into this week's edition of Bob's Take. And Bob, I want to start by talking about something that I'm looking forward to torturing Tony Collins with here in a little bit. And that's the thoughts on the miracle in Miami. It was the first time, I think, that we've ever seen that multilateral play actually work. So, Bob, where does that play rank amongst the all-time great endings to a football game?
You know, it was amazing, Chris. The first thing I thought of while watching it and was how many people probably missed it that were watching it. Because think about it, when you have a few seconds left in the game and the team is down by a touchdown and it's just a kickoff, you're going to change the channel, correct? Most people would. I was on the computer at the time, probably the only reason why I didn't turn the channel. So that was my first thought. But you got to think, yeah, one of the most exciting, especially when New England is involved, obviously. You just don't expect it, and you don't think a well-coached team would ever give that up. A lot of things that went into it being big, you know. I mean, there's been some great endings. You know, we can talk about the Music City Miracle and, of course, the Super Bowl a couple years. I don't think anything tops that Super Bowl a few years ago with Malcolm Butler, with the whole Russell Wilson fiasco. But there's been many games like that, Chris. But, yeah, I mean, just for an unexpected ending, I would say it's right up there because, again, you just had it in the win column already. I wouldn't be surprised if media outlets had it on the W board went to another game. It was crazy, but again, shame on New England, and we could talk about it, about the whole coaching job by Belichick having Gronkowski in the game, but it was just pathetic defense on their part, and it's got to be something that they'll have to address, but wow, it was just wow.
Yeah, it was a wow. I couldn't believe it when I saw it. You know, we've seen that play, you know, 1,000 times where, you know, guys are throwing it all over the place. It typically ends in a fumble or something along those lines and the game's over. And to see it actually work, oh my goodness. Next, Bob, I want to get your thoughts on the Bears. They really shut the Rams offense down last week. A game I had, that was one of the two that I told Tony that I was going to leapfrog him in our five-star picks of the week. And I actually got that one right. Got the other one that was sort of off the wall wrong, but at least I got that one right. But shut the Rams down. They held them to 6 points. Gurley only had 28 yards rushing. Goff, 180 yards passing. So your thoughts, Bob. Are the Bears suddenly a real contender now in the NFC?
You have to think so, Chris, because that was a great test. I mean, yeah, they were playing at home and everything, and we knew about their defense. Their defense continues along with teams like Dallas. It's one of the better defenses out there. You know, I think they were a little overrated throughout the season, but they came up big that game. And the Bears, I think what's quietly going under the radar with the Bears, Chris, is their offense has scored an awful lot of points this year, and people think this was one of those dirty, you know, defensive-only squads. That's not the case. They scored 359 points, which is huge. And, of course, Chris, if they were to get a home game or something, they don't lose at the Soldier Field much. So, yeah, there's something to be reckoned with. If you can hold the Rams to that many points and just totally shut down a team like that, yeah, they're dangerous on any given weekend.
One more, Bob. And speaking of teams playing great defense, the Cowboys are now the hottest team in the league. You want to talk about a coach that went from being about fired to now having a team that has won five games in a row and you know, perhaps, you know, the talk of the league after with that winning streak, right? No one else even close. We saw them completely shut down the Saints a couple of weeks ago. So now we talk about the Bears now being in the conversation for teams that could win in the NFC. Are the Cowboys a part of that conversation as well?
As I just said, Chris, they have a defense that's given up less points than the Bears. It's been shocking, to say the least. They play very well at home. You know, it's going to be hard for them to get some home playoff wins, and they do have to get things better on the road. But again, it seems like, you know, a guy like Cooper is energized. The franchise looks like Elliott is kind of back to what he was when he first came in the league. And, you know, that they have Dallas. The fans are back into it big time. And on this show, you and I a few times have brought up Jason Garrett's coaching status when it was – I think he was right at the end of the line at times, even though he's getting these good reviews, should we say, by Jerry Jones. I mean, I thought he was really toward the end there, and his time had come and gone. But it's just everything's been reborn there, Chris. I mean, I think they still are kind of looking at the tight end position, hoping Jason Witten would come back, which they're not going to get. But anyway, I mean, yeah, they're in good shape right now. I think this week's game is going to be a toss-up between them and the Colts because both teams need it. That might be the game of the week outside of maybe tonight.
Yeah, and I tell you what, Bob, you make a good point. Talk about how Cooper has done a good job of maybe, you know, reinvigorating this offense. So, you know, the next question that you're going to get, you know, the layer of this onion, right, you got to ask is, when you look at the Raiders, right, they give up Amari Cooper, they give up Khalil Mack. Both of those are now on the teams we just talked about being, a team that have an opportunity now to go far into the playoffs. If you're a Raider fan, you got to be shaking your head, right? You know, yeah, I get that we got a couple of first round draft picks out of this, but look at what these two guys are doing.
Yeah. it's crazy, but yeah, you're right. I mean, nightmare for one is the dream of another, and that's what's going on with the Raiders and Cowboys.
That's right. All right, there you go, folks. That's this week's edition of Bob's Take. And Bob, before we move on, you know, every single week you're adding more and more great interviews from your to your Monday Night Sports 14 YouTube channel. Talk about some of the ones you put up again this week.
Yeah, a few of this week's we've posted on Twitter. A couple of them are friends of ours, Chris. We had Hall of Famer Lem Barney on the show. We posted that a few days ago, and earlier today, our good friend Moose Muhammad, Chris, we put that interview up there. But, yeah, you can go and see the entire collection. YouTube, go to Monday Night Sports 14 and check out some of every sport.
All right, folks, as you guys know, here on TNT, we are sponsored by the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory. And if you love the game of baseball, please go online to check them out at Louisville Slugger or SluggerMuseum.com. What a wonderful place. They won the TripAdvisor Certificate of Excellence Hall of Fame Award this year. The museum is a very cool experience for everybody in your family because you get to go in there and walk their live production line and see some of the 1.8 million bats that they make, and they've been doing it now for 134 years. Also, while you're there, you've got to go into the bat vault. You get to go in there and hold game-used bats from some of the game's greatest legends. Guys like Hank Aaron, Ted Williams, my hero growing up, Willie Stargell. Again, go online to find out more information and to book your visit to SluggerMuseum.com. We're also proud to be sponsored by our good friend and TNT Hall of Famer Randy Minear and the great folks at the Salt Creek Golf Retreat up in beautiful Nashville, Indiana, which, oh, by the way, was voted one of the top 20 small towns in the country by Smithsonian Magazine, as well as one of our newer TNT Hall of Famers from this year's class, former Houston Oilers quarterback Dan Pastorini, and DP Quality Foods. Again, go online and check out Dan's array of spices by going online to dpqualityfoods.com. All right, now back with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is former Falcons running back Lynn Cain. We had so much fun with Lynn when he joined us a couple of months ago. Really wanted to get him back on the show as quickly as we could. Lynn is from Los Angeles, California, played his college ball at USC, where he helped the Trojans to three bowl victories, including the 1979 Rose Bowl over Michigan and the national championship that season. They won that, you know, according to the UPI. We had a split poll that year, but UPI gave them the national championship and richly deserved. He was a fourth-round draft pick, the number 100 overall selection in 1979 by the Atlanta Falcons. Played here in Atlanta from 79 to 84. Played his last season back home in L.A. for the Rams. Over the course of his NFL career, he rushed for just over 2,300 yards and had nearly 1,100 receiving yards, and he scored 25 touchdowns. The Atlanta Journal-Constitution named Lynn one of the top 50 Falcons of all time, and we're excited he is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Lynn, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Happy holidays, Lynn.
Happy holidays, Chris and Bob. Glad to be back on the show with you guys. Really exciting and looking forward.
So are we. So, Lynn, I want to start by going back to your time at, or getting your thoughts, I should say, on your alma mater, USC. Ended the season 5-7 this year, a rare college football season that won't include USC in a bowl game anywhere. So I'm sure that's not what you were looking for out of the Trojans this year. So I wanted to get your thoughts on the direction they're headed in.
I remember an alumni asked me a question. I went back for the the Notre Dame game against USC, and this was a while back. And he asked me the question along the lines of what I thought about mediocrity. And I looked at him. I said, well, it's unacceptable at USC. You know, and that's what I think of is there's a high standard that's there. It's always been there. It was there when, you go way back to the days of Taylor, running back in the day. You go that far back, and it's always been a standard of playing good, excellent football. You know, you come out, you get yourself positioned for the Pac-10 championship, you win that, or the Pac-12 today. You win that Pac-12 championship, then you go on, then it's the national championship that you're thinking about, and you're always wanting to get in position of that every year. And that's a mindset that they instill in your players. I know when I was there with John Robinson and John McKay, that was the mindset. It was always players letting other players know that this is the expectation that's here, and we got to go out and play to that expectation. Like it or not, that's the way it is. I remember when they had a celebration of the 78 team. They brought us back. They announced us. And John Robinson got up. This is when Pete Carroll was the coach. And John Robinson said, Pete, I got advice for you. He said, win and keep winning. That's the goal. Win and keep winning. And, you know, Pete had that run of, what, seven Pac-12 championships, somewhere around there of a run. And that's the way it is at SC. Yeah.
And Lynn, to your point about mediocrity and that not being acceptable, do you think this is a blip on the radar and they'll get things straightened out, or do you think something needs to change?
Well, in my opinion, and this is just as I tell my wife, you're asking me my opinion, then I'll share that what I think part of it. And this is from my experience / being a coach / a head coach. You know, it is, you don't want those blips. You don't want them back to back. You just don't. You're striving towards every year. And this is where the kind of athletes that my understanding of when looking at John McKay or John Robinson, who they recruited, and even today, Helton and the players that they recruit, you recruit players there, can get it done, and you work at getting it done every year. You know, each year, it's a mindset that you go out and you develop that. And it's up to the coach to help coaches and players get to that maximum potential spot. And that's a difficult thing, man. That's a difficult thing, a point to get to with reaching that goal. Every week you're going out and you're playing your best and competing your best and getting your athletes out, especially today. You know, they have less time. Back when we played, they had more time to have us in practice. And we would be there in practice, and they can hold us to practice for a long time into the evening. And so, you know, there's a little difference that you have, but the expectation is still there, man. It's still at SC, you know. It's not 8-9. It's not 9-4. It's about positioning yourself to compete for the Pac-12 championship, and then competing for the national championship. You're lining yourself up. It's just that's the way it is there at SC.
And Lynn, right up there with USC, get your thoughts on the Falcons so far this season. I don't think any of us thought we'd be sitting here and they'd be 4-9 in the midst of a 5-game losing streak. And looking back, you know, to the Super Bowl appearance a couple of years ago, we thought, you know what, maybe this is a young team on the rise and they would be right back in the Super Bowl. If it wasn't the next year, it would certainly be the year after. And it certainly hasn't gone that way. Your thoughts on what you're seeing from the Falcons?
You know, once again, when I got to the Falcons, there was a standard that was always there. And Wallace Francis. Wallace Francis played with the Buffalo Bills, and then he was sent to the Atlanta Falcons. And Wallace, I stay in contact with Wallace, and Wallace just always, he's like, man, Kane, I remember you came out, you were practicing, and there was a standard that you had in practice, a self-standard. This is one, you know, not based upon your team standard. This is an individual standard that was taught to us, taught to me at the University of Southern California. Running backs would run 20, 30 yards every time you touched the ball. That was your conditioning, the type of thing. So you got your work in to it. And that's what I, you know, when I think about the current day Falcons today, they're highly trained. They're highly conditioned. Getting them prepared every week is an important factor. And I would think that, you know, I know that the coach comes from Pete Carroll's staff, and I was there when Pete was at USC, and Pete is a tremendous motivator, inspirator. Coming out every practice was about getting yourself, maximizing your potential. Now, there's those days that rest days, thank God, they have rest days today. And so when I think of the Falcons today, I wonder if they're meeting that standard on a regular basis and then the players committing to that standard. They got to be a commitment. I remember back in the day that when I played with the Falcons, that 1980 season, and I know you had that on your mind, that 1980 season, when we went into that season, we were 3-3, and we were not heading – we were heading towards a poor season. And the players called a meeting. We all called a meeting. We sat down, and players in that meeting decided to commit to playing that year. You're not going out, not doing things and partying, having fun, but committing to working toward getting in shape, or continue to keep yourself in shape, continue with your conditioning, continue with watching film, getting better, meeting together as a group, being on time, doing all those things, getting your rest. And fellas, we're 12-4. We were 12-4. It wasn't an accident. I remember a St. Louis game. We're playing against St. Louis, and they had us down 24-3, I think, something like that. They were beating us by halftime. We turned them out and came back and went into overtime, tied them up, went into overtime, and beat them in overtime. And that just propelled our season off. I remember Wallace Francis walking the sideline. Men, stay, hang in there. Don't quit. Hang in there. We're going to turn this thing around. And people hung in there. We hung in there. You know, every down, every snap, we hung in there, turned the thing around. And that's what I would think that's needed right now. I just don't see that push. One, I don't see whatever happened to the running back has been injured. When he was, going to the Super Bowl, you had, remember, our running backs were doing a great job. And then our offensive line was doing a fantastic job of pass blocking and run blocking. I just don't see that combination happening. I don't see on defense. Remember, defense came out, one of our big problems in the Super Bowl, we kind of ran out of gas. We ran out of gas, and the guys seemed to be tired by the second half. But the intensity of the defense, we had a tremendous defense, and we was ranked pretty high back then offensively and defensively. But I just don't see that hunger like I did a few years ago. So,
Bob, questions for Lynn?
Great to have you on again, Lynn. And your first year with the Falcons was also the first year of William Andrews with the Falcons. And for those who remember, Lynn, I mean, William Andrews, if he had had a longer career, I don't think there's any question that he had Hall of Fame talent. He had 4 1,000-yard seasons in that short stretch, but was there an awful lot of competition in that very first training camp, Lynn? And tell our listeners more about the greatness of William Andrews.
Bob, it was a pleasure, a joy to be in the backfield with William Andrews. And yes, it was competition, and it was fun competition, what I saw. You know, William and I, there's a picture we have where one of us scored, and as we're running off the field, we're holding hands. We interlocked our hands, right? And we're jogging off, and that's the connection that I remember. I remember during summer camp when we were competing, and we had a lot of backs. They were looking for backs. Their running game, felt like they had the offensive line, which is dead. Mike Kent, R.C. Thielman, Warren Bryant, and then Jeff Enno, that's center, and R.C. Thielman. You know, they had all these the linemen in place, and they felt like they needed the running game. And so they opened it up for competition. Well, as I was running, practicing, and I kept realizing every time I got in the backfield with William, you can see a click, you know, and I felt good, you know, and he felt good about it. And I remember that San Francisco game when Lehman Bennett walks in, I'm sitting up on a table, man, and I'm getting taped, and he walks over, and Lehman always rolled up a program, and he had a program rolled up, and he hit me on my ankles, you know, patted me on the ankles, and he looked up at me. I looked up, and he says, how you doing this morning? I said, I'm doing fantastic, Coach. How are you doing? He says, great. He says, you're starting today. Oh, man, I just about sunk in my man, I just sunk. I was like, oh, my God, you're starting today. And I went from I was a seventh or eighth running back. They had Bubba Bean and Haskell Standback. They had a slew of guys that were in front of me. George Franklin, 6'5". This kid was 6'4", 245 pounds, ran a 4.540. I mean, this guy – accelerate. But I made it. I hung in there. I blocked my rear end off. I ran. And if they gave me one carry, I make the best of that one carry. And I was able to make it on the team. And then William Andrews in the backfield. William Andrews we called ourselves the every down back. We can be in their first down, second down, or leave us in there third down because we can catch, we can run, we can block. We shared the backfield with one another. We blocked for each other. We did all those things in there. Now, here's a story that William told me, which is a tremendous compliment, I would say. He went to the Pro Bowl, and John McKay was the coach, and he said, man, John McKay's talking about who's going to play what quarter, and, you know, Walter Payton and someone else, Anderson, Otis Anderson, something like that. You're in the first quarter, and then somebody, Earl Campbell and somebody else, you're in the second quarter, and then William Andrews and so-and-so, you're in the third quarter, and then somebody in the fourth quarter. Well, William Andrews said he's sitting on the bench, and the first quarter, John McKay walks over and taps him on the shoulder and says, William Andrews. He says, yes, sir. He says, you're going into the game this first series. You're in the game. He said, no, Coach, you told me I was going in the third quarter. He said, William Andrews, you're going in to the game. He said, no, Coach, you told me I was going in. And Walter Payton walks over and says, William Andrews, you're going in with me. I told the coach that I want you in the backfield because I know you'll block for me, and I'll block for you. Isn't that something, man?
Yeah, that's great.
The Walter Payton walks over and says, put William Andrews in the backfield with me because I know he's going to block, catch, run, and whatever else you ask him to do. And that was a fun thing. I enjoyed playing in the backfield with William.
And, Lynn, just a few words about Steve Barkowski. We were fortunate enough to have him on the show before, and this was a guy that threw 55 completions to you a couple years later. And we know this guy, when he had the 31 touchdowns in 80, and he followed that up with a 30-touchdown season in 81, that's when people weren't doing that kind of stuff, Lynn. And Barkowski, a California guy, very cerebral guy. Your memories of him?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. Bart was, I won't make this story long, I'll just put it this way. I was out on the field watching a quarterback or a team practice. They had asked me to come, and I was there watching practice. And there was this one quarterback that played in the NFL, and he threw the ball. And when he threw the ball, I looked and I saw the kite spiral, and I could see that ball in the air, and he threw a deep route. And I'm looking at that ball. Then I turned around and looked at the quarterback, and I said to him this, you know what? Watching your spiral, it just brought up memories of why I missed playing in the NFL. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
The spiral. So let me say this. Steve Borkowski had one of the tightest spirals I've seen in my playing days. I watched that guy throw the ball, and he could throw it any way that he wanted. He had a tremendous arm. Him and June Jones used to have fun games that they would play where they'd take a helmet and put it 10 yards away, 15 yards, 20 yards, 30 yards, 50 yards, and see who can hit the helmet. And when you hit the helmet, then you back up 10 yards or 5 yards, whatever that number was that they used. And they back up, and then boom, you hit the back it up, boom. And I saw Steve Borkowski hit those helmets.
Wow.
You hear what I'm saying? I saw
yeah.
that hit. If he can hit a helmet like that, and then I saw him hit the field goal post. Wow. You're standing there going, wow, look at this guy. It's amazing things that he was. And then you see him throw the ball. As soon as you snap, they would always say that to a wide receiver or a running back, if you're a receiver catching a ball, if you're running routes, they would say, you better whip your head around and bring your hands quickly because the ball's coming. And if you didn't, Steve was told, hit him in the face mask. And I tell you what, man, if you didn't snap your head around quick enough and get your hands around to get ready to catch the ball, it'd hit you in the face mask. Steve Borkowski was a heck of a quarterback. And had a tremendous arm, tremendous. I used to love, I'll finish on this note. I used to love watching Alfred Jenkins and the Wallace Francis and Alfred Jackson. And then you asked me, there you talked about Junior Miller. They lined Junior Miller from tight end position, tight end position, and would move him out to the X receiver or Z, well, X, then move him out to the split end position. And that guy would, Bart would throw the ball. He'd throw like a rainbow, man. He'd throw the ball up high and let it drop and let those guys go run and catch it. And watching them run down there catching his ball, it was a beautiful sight to see. He was a heck of a quarterback. I just felt bad that we were 2 games away from the Super Bowl, man. 2 games away, and we didn't finish the job. We had Dallas right there where we needed to. 14 points we're up, but we didn't close the deal. We had with 2 minutes, less than 2 minutes left in the game, we had an opportunity to steal the deal, but we didn't get the first down. We give the ball back, and they go down and score and beat us. And I feel bad for Steve Borkowski because he didn't get that chance to be in a Super Bowl or play against Philly the next week and have the chance to play in the Super Bowl the following week against the Oakland Raiders. And that would have been a lot of fun. And this is why it would have been a lot of fun. Let me sneak this caveat in there, please. It would have been a lot of fun because the Mike Davis played with the Oakland Raiders, was a defensive back. I played with Mike when we were in junior college. We played junior college today together. And we won the state championship there at East LA Community College. And I was looking forward to that competition with Mike on the field, because then it would have gave one of us bragging rights. Well, I didn't get there, man. I didn't get there.
Well, Lynn, we certainly love every opportunity to get to spend with you. You're so much fun to have as part of the show. So many other things we would have loved to have gotten in with you tonight, and unfortunately just not enough time. I hope you'll come back and join us again soon and share more of your stories and your insights. You're a lot of fun.
Man, I love you. Thank you for inviting me back. I'd love for that opportunity. Seriously, if you can sneak me in one more time, 10 more times, 100 times, that would be great.
We'll be there. Absolutely we can. So we'll make that happen.
All right.
Lynn, Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Happy holidays to you and your family. We'll catch up soon.
Be well, Lynn.
Same to you, too. Thank you.
Take care.
See you.
Bye.
That is former Falcons running back Lynn Cain. Always so much fun, Bob. I enjoy having Lynn as part of the show. Always makes me smile as he's telling his stories.
Yeah, I love those old Falcon teams, you know, Fulton County. So you remember them well, Chris. I mean, it was Barkowski and company. Great, great bunch of guys to watch.
We've got our next guest, Tony Collins, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Tony after this real quick station break.
You're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari, where NFL legends live on. Back to you, boys.
It's him. He's alive.
And now back with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins. Tony, have you recovered from the heart attack I'm sure you suffered last week watching the Dolphins miracle in Miami?
Here, he's here.
Oh, my God. And the bad thing about it, they keep showing it over and over and over again. Unbelievable, man.
No
Unbelievable.
Doubt.
How you guys doing?
When I was watching, I thought, you know, I got to go on Facebook and see if Tony had sent something out.
I couldn't believe it. I'm glad you're here.
No doubt. So, Tony, last week I went out on a limb with a couple of picks, hoping to leapfrog you in the standings, but ended up getting one right, getting one wrong. The Bears came through for me. I had them over the Rams. Unfortunately, I had the Vikings over the Seahawks, and that one didn't work out. Both you and Bob had Seattle, so that one cost me. So when I was hoping to leapfrog you, you and I both finished 3-2, so no blood there. Bob, on the other hand, goes 4-1. He had the Colts over the Texans. He got that one on us, and we all had the Ravens over the Chiefs and the Cowboys over the Eagles. So we were 3-2, Bob 4-1. So for the season, Tony, you maintain a one-game lead over me. Bob catches up and ties me for second. He's also one game back. So it's razor thin as we go to the last 3 weeks of the regular season. So you got a one-game lead, my friend, but we're hot on your trail.
I'll take it.
All right, so our first game this week is actually tonight's game going on over, I'm sure, all of our shoulders. We got the 10-3 Chargers at the 11-2 Chiefs. The Chiefs are a four-point home favorite, the over-under 54.5. So, Tony, any way the Chargers can go into Arrowhead and come out with a huge win?
Tough to come into Arrowhead and beat Kansas City, man. I mean, L.A.'s playing some good football, man. I love what they're doing. I know they're missing their running back right now, but, man, it's just so tough to beat KC in KC. So I got to go with KC. Not a sure thing. I think it's going to be a tight game, a lot of points scored. So we're going to say 37-34 Kansas City.
All right. Bob, what do you think?
Wow, I had a high-scoring game, too. I agree with Tony. I mean, to go into Kansas City is hard enough, but when you're missing a major offensive cog like Gordon, it's too much to overcome. You know, the team has been doing well, but Kansas City, the way Mahomes is playing and just that sea of red, Chris, high-scoring game, Kansas City 38-28.
All right. And I'm with you guys. I like the Chiefs as well. I just don't think you can go into Arrowhead and get a win. I mean, at some point, you would have to believe Pat Mahomes is going to have a bad game, but I don't think it's tonight. I don't think it's at home at this point in the season. Maybe at the last game or two, he'll throw up something. But you look at the Chargers and Tony, I'm with you. I like what the Chargers are doing. I don't think there's another team in football though that covers as poorly as the Steelers do. So I don't think he can have that second half success here against the Chiefs. And Ford is eighth game I think in a row now with a sack. That Chiefs defense is getting a little bit better. They're not great, but they're getting a little bit better. And I'm with you guys. I think it's a high-scoring game. I'm taking Kansas City to win 34-31. Our second game is the 5-7-1 Packers going to the 9-4 Bears. The Bears are a 6-point home favorite, the over-under 45. Tony, can a Mike McCarthy-less Packers team somehow upset the Bears in Chicago?
Gotta be tough, man. Those two teams, they fight it out every year, man, twice a year. So, I mean, but Chicago's playing some good football. Their defense is probably one of the top-ranked defense in the league right now. Their offense is clicking a little bit, scoring some points. So I'm going to have to go with Chicago. But it's going to be a close game because on the other side, they got that guy named Aaron Rodgers. He just can never count him out. So we'll go Chicago 24. Green Bay 21.
Okay. Bob, what do you think?
As I mentioned at the beginning, Chris, again, I think the Bears offense has been underrated. They have gotten so many great things said about their defense, and rightly so. But Chicago, I mean, at home, Chris, they're one of the best home teams in football. And after I became a major believer last week defensively, if they can shut down the Rams, they can shut down Rodgers for sure. So, yeah, at home, I see Chicago winning. I'm going to say 27-24. Close game, but Chicago ekes it out.
And, guys, I'm really loving this Bears defense. You guys have heard me say it multiple times over the years. Defense wins championships. Offenses do not. The Bears clamped down on the Rams. They did a great job, held them to 6 points. Gurley to 28 yards rushing. Goff, 180 yards passing. You know, they were able to overcome their own three interceptions that Mitch Trubisky threw. But the Bears, you know, they're third in average points allowed. They're, you know, within a half a point from being the best defense in football there. They're second in rushing defense. The Packers seem to be a team in turmoil. To your point, Tony, they still have Aaron Rodgers, who's still playing at a high level, as he always does. Only one interception thrown this year. So he's playing well, but I like the Bears at home. I'm going to take them as well, 27-24, exactly where you had it, Bob. Our third game is the 8-5 Cowboys going to the 7-6 Colts. The Colts are a 3-point home favorite, over under 47. Tony, who do you like here?
They're playing in Indianapolis?
They are playing in Indianapolis.
Yes.
You know what? I like what the Colts are doing right now. I know Dallas is pretty hot and they're playing some good football. But I don't know who's favored off the line. I don't know what the line is, but I'm going with the Colts on this
Colts
game.
Colts by three. Colts?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm definitely going with the Colts. I'm going to go with the Colts, man, just because they're playing good football, man. They are. I know Dallas is hot, but for some reason, man, Dallas can't – they seem to always mess up and do something stupid at the end. So we're going to go with the Colts. And a pretty close game as well. We're going to go 31-24 Indianapolis.
All right. Bob, what do you think?
I think it was a great recap by Tony. I mean, Dallas is one of those teams that just – they're not a good road team, guys. And then the Colts, I mean, their backs were against the wall last week. I picked them. I thought that this is the time they have to rise. And with Luck and – Hilton and all those guys doing what they're doing at home, that place is still going to be electric, and I think they can beat Dallas. And I'm going to say Indy pulls out this one, too. I'm going to say 30-24.
30-24. All right. Well, guys, you know, I like seeing what Andrew Luck is doing. He's having a great comeback season. He's fifth in passing yards. He's got 34 touchdowns on the season so far. He's thrown the second most picks in the league. Now he's got 13. He's tied for second with Ben Roethlisberger in that category. And the defense is just sort of the middle of the road. Right? They're 15th in just about every category. But, you know, what really hurts them is they just can't run the football. They're 24th in the league in rushing offense. So they're pretty one-dimensional, which makes you pretty predictable. And when you play a defense like the Cowboys, who are fourth overall and second in average points allowed, and a defense that held Drew Brees to almost nothing, I just don't think it looks good for you. Guys, I'm going the opposite direction. I'm taking the Cowboys to win a big one on the road, 27-20. We've got two more games to pick. We've got our next guest, Alex Molden, hanging on the line. Going to get to Alex in just a moment. Our fourth game this week are the pesky 7-6 Dolphins, Tony, going to the 6-6-1 Vikings. And the Vikings are a 7.5-point home favorite. Over-under is 44.5. So, Tony, do the Dolphins have a second miracle in them? Can they win on the road in Minnesota?
I hope the Dolphins don't win another game for the rest of the year.
Good job, you don't.
But no, seriously, man, it's. I think it's going to be another tight game. I like the Vikings defense. Miami is a team that they're playing. They play good at home. Now, again, where are they playing at? Tell me again where they're playing at.
In Minnesota.
That's where it goes wrong for the Dolphins. They play good at home, but I don't think they play good on the road. So I'm going with the Vikings, and not a lot of points scored. We're going to go 17-13, Minnesota.
Ooh, a little low scoring game, a little pitcher's duel. Bob, what do you think?
I agree with Tony again. Minnesota at home. I mean, let's face it, guys. Miami should be 0-6 on the road, and they're not going to be able to perform any magic in there. I mean, Minnesota has to win this game to at least keep up in that the wild card fight. So, yeah, Minnesota at home. I'm going to say they win 24-20.
Okay. And guys, I'm not a Dolphins believer either. I don't believe in Tannehill. They're 27th in passing offense, 22nd in average points scored per game in their defense. If they're not playing the Patriots in Miami, their defense is just awful. They're 26th in average points allowed. So I think there's no miracle here. I'm with you guys. I'm taking the Vikings 31-20. Our last game, and here we go, Tony. The 9-4 Patriots, losers of two of their last three games, going to my even worse Steelers, 7-5-1, losers of three in a row. It was supposed to be the regular season game of the year, but the Steelers are so bad that the Patriots are a 2.5-point road favorite in Pittsburgh, which is embarrassing, and the over-under is 52. So, Tony, how big of an upset is it going to be when my Steelers get revenge on your Patriots from last season's robbery?
Wow. Do you actually think that's going to happen after what happened to us last week? Let me tell you something. Belichick's going to have those boys ready. And from when I was watching the Steelers play the Raiders and how they played that game, I was like, come on. I know the Steelers are going to beat the Raiders. The Raiders. Come on. So I just can't see. I know they're playing at home. But, man, it's just something's missing with the Steelers right now, man. I don't know what it is. And now they got to play against New England, my team, which coming off a loss, they usually win coming off a loss. They don't lose too many games, too many times. They lose two games in a row. So I got to go with my boys. And I'm going to tell you, man, it might be a big one for us to go in there and stomp your boys pretty good. So we're going to go 31-13.
Ooh, 13. Wow. Bob, is Tony right?
I agree with Tony, Chris. I mean, if they had played a close game last or even a blowout game over Miami, I think the Steelers would have a better shot. I mean, they're just, you know, they have to be smart. They have to be incredibly perturbed right now. These two teams are very evenly matched. If you look at the points for, points against, they're almost identical. But Pittsburgh is not invincible at home at all. And I just think New England, after that sour taste, they just want to make sure they put their stamp back on top, who's the best team around. And I think they go in there, and, I get a little magic toward the end there. But they'll win 34-27.
Okay. And, guys, you know I want to be a homer. I want to say the Steelers are going to win. But you know what? There's no way that's going to happen. I heard Artie Burns is actually going to start at defensive back, and I'm 100% sure that when Tom Brady heard that, he started laughing and shaking his head, saying, the Steelers are so dumb. I can't believe how dumb they are. Artie Burns couldn't cover me, let alone Josh Gordon. So, you know, Brady and Gronk are going to torture the Steelers' defense. You know, the Steelers haven't been able to cover a tight end since the 90s. So I'm with you guys. I got to say, the Patriots are going to win this game. Not only going to win this game, they're going to win it big. They're going to win 48-34. I'm taking the Patriots.
Say it ain't so, Chris. Say it ain't so.
You know, Tony, I mean, Tony, to your point, we can't beat the Raiders. We couldn't stop the Raiders from scoring two touchdowns in the last 5.5 minutes in that game to blow it. There's no way we're stopping Tom Brady. You got to be kidding me. Tony, before we let you go, remind our listeners about the great thing you do to try to help kids go to college.
TonyCollinsFoundation.org. Try to get as many kids into school as we can. Go to the website, donate as much as you can, helping the youth go off to college.
You're the best, Tony. We'll catch up with you again next week. In between now and then, all the best to you and your family.
Have a great week, Tony.
God bless, guys. Have a great one.
Take care.
See you, Tony. We've got our next guest, Alex Molden, hanging on the line. Going to get the Alex on the other side of this quick station break.
Thursday Night Tailgate, where the spotlight is always on the positive. Tune in Thursday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time to hear your favorite NFL legends, players, and coaches sharing their stories. Now back to Chris and Bob.
I wouldn't joke about anything else that happened to you tonight.
And now joining us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is Alex Molden. Let me give you some background on Alex. He is from Detroit, Michigan, played his college ball at Oregon, where he was named All-Pac-10 in 1994, an All-Pac-10 and an All-American in 95. He was a first-round draft pick, the number 11 overall selection in 1996 by the New Orleans Saints, and played in the NFL from 96 to 2003 for the Saints, Chargers, and Lions. And over the course of his career, He had 296 tackles, 12 interceptions. He forced 5 fumbles and recovered 4 of them. And we're excited that he is with us tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Alex, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming on the show.
Welcome, Alex.
Hey, you got it. How you guys doing?
We're fantastic, Alex. How are you?
I'm all right. Can't complain.
Alex, I want to start off our time with you tonight, and I was doing some research on you, and I read that you started off at a very young age participating in track and field at an army base over in Germany, and you were a really great sprinter and a long jumper as well, really going all the way back to when you were 8 or 9 years old. So talk about, you know, growing up, on an army base, doing the things that you did and how that track helped you translate that into being such a great football player.
Yeah, for sure. No, we started off, I'm originally from Detroit, and I lived in Oklahoma and, you know, moved out to Germany when I was, I believe, like 8 or 9. It was my first time ever competing in track and field. And, I was just like the other kids, just running. And, I love being outdoors and competing. And, I found out, the love that I had for jumping. And come to find out, I was pretty good at it. And, it was this one meet that I can remember where, they kept raising the bar and I kept jumping and I was competing against, this other kid. And I started to leave him in the dust. And then all of a sudden it was just me. And I don't remember how high I was jumping, but it was pretty cool where, a lot of the kids nearby was coming over and they started cheering me on. So from that moment on, I knew I had something, just something a little bit different and, something, athletically I was, somewhat gifted. And then from there, man, I just, played different sports. I didn't play organized football until I was in 8th grade. And, played for the boys club, which now is the boys and girls club, but back then it was just the boys club. And I was able to do that. And, the reason I did it was, it was free and, we didn't have a whole bunch of money. So, did that and we lost every game. We went 0-8, but I loved everything about football. I loved the contact and the competitiveness and, the game planning and the team aspect of it. And, from there, I just kind of, learned more about it. I started, reading encyclopedias to learn more about, the game and the different positions, because they didn't, there was no internet, there was no magazines, my dad didn't, he never played the game. So, I just, went to, to an encyclopedia. And then one of my good buddies, he ended up having this, he ordered Sports Illustrated. And back then, when you ordered Sports Illustrated, you got this free tape, this videotape, VHS, and it was called Crunch Course. And that changed the game for me. After watching that and watching, they had Walter Payton, they had Lawrence Taylor, they had all type of guys like that in there. And I just knew, like, this is what I wanted to do. I was going to play football no matter what. And from there, just kind of kept learning and kept developing myself, especially in the off season. I understood how important, like, training was, lifting weights and working on my athleticism. And, yeah, from there, man, just went to University of Oregon and continued to learn and grow and start to build a football IQ and, was blessed enough to play at the highest level. So in a nutshell, that's me kind of learning, about football and all the gifts that it kind of brought me and my family.
And Alex, as I was looking over some of the things that you accomplished, I got to imagine one of the things right at the top of the list, I look at your time at Oregon. 92, you guys go to the Independence Bowl to play Wake Forest, and you suffer a devastating knee injury. I mean, tearing your ACL, MCL, and PCL. I mean, everything in your knee.
Yeah.
You had no more L's.
Yeah.
Everything gone. And you make it back less than a year later. 10 months, you're back out on the field playing. Talk about what happened and the determination you had to get all the way back, and not just back to play, but back at an All-American level.
Yeah, well, you know, it was one of those, just a blessing in disguise. And I ended up, shredding up my knee. And, you know, I was devastated. You know, I just knew that, you know, thinking that was it. I would never be able to play football again. And if I did, I wouldn't be able to play at the same high level. And once I asked the doctor, I said, Doc, you know, I was down. I said, Doc, will I ever be able to play football again? And will I be able to be good again? And he looked at me and he chuckled. He said, Alex, you're going to come back better, man. And that's all he needed to say. The conviction that he had, the confidence that he spoke with, that's all I needed to hear. And so I proceeded to do everything that the trainers asked me to do. I was blessed to be able to have Coach Jimmy Radcliffe, a world-renowned strength conditioning coach that we had at University of Oregon. And I had a chance to train with him for 1 hour a day, 5 days a week for 8 months straight. And he taught me how to run. You know, I was fast beforehand, but, you know, I never learned the skill of running. And I was able to to get that skill. You know, he broke it down into bite-sized chunks where I can be able to understand it. And I learned how to be efficient in movement, not just with running, but with jumping and with change of direction. So, you know, I came back 9 months later. Now, I still wasn't the same athlete, but that next year, it was a game changer because now, you know, because I had to use a third of my patellar tendon. So I often had tendonitis and that set me back a little bit. But that next year, I was playing at a very high level. And on top of that, I was able to study more film. And like I said, you know, develop a higher football IQ. And so that year, you know, it was a devastating knee injury. I wouldn't wish it on anybody, but I was able to use that as a benefit instead of a detriment.
Bob, questions for Alex?
Thanks so much for joining us, Alex. And I like to ask our guests about their introductions to the NFL. And that 96 Saints team, Alex, I mean, had our good friend Jim Everett on the offensive side. On the defensive side, you had some great veterans like Wayne Martin, who I always thought was so underrated, and Greg Jackson. Any of these guys, especially on the defensive end, that kind of took you under their wing and made your path to the NFL easier?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we did have a great defensive team, you know, in my years in New Orleans. And, you know, exactly. Wayne Martin was the most underrated defensive tackle that I've ever, you know, had a pleasure to play with or against. And so him, he was great, but the guys that took me under their wing was the guys in the secondary, Eric Allen, and Anthony Newman. And so I've known Anthony Newman for a long time. He's from Portland and he went to University of Oregon. And so he really, you know, looked after me. Same thing as Eric Allen. They were open books. And also Richard Harvey played outside linebacker for us. He's the one that kind of told me what I needed to do to be a pro, taking care of my body. You know, it's, you know, the food that I ate, you know, massage therapist, acupuncturist, chiropractor. He was the guy that was pointing me in the direction. So, you know, I learned a lot, you know, and, you know, it was very humbling, but it was something that I'm glad that those guys took the time out to, you know, to kind of welcome me to the club and take me underneath their wing.
It was a rough season, Alex. I mean, 3-13, but then, of course, they made the coaching change. You guys did improve under Ditka the next year, and it was a great coaching staff. You look at some of the names, Del Rio and Tom Moore, Willie Shaw, Venturi, I can keep going. But Ditka especially, and we hope he's feeling better these days. Tell me about the experience playing under him. We've had many guys that done it, and most guys have a lot of respect for the man.
Yeah, I mean, he was a coach that, you know, he demanded a lot. He was hard-nosed, and I respected that from him. You know, I ended up getting in his doghouse my fourth year, so in 1999. And, you know, we had a conversation, and, you know, he always said that it was open door policy, and so I took advantage of that. And it didn't turn out quite the way I expected, and I ended up asking for a trade, and that backfired, and I stayed with the team, but, you know, I was rarely touching the field that year. But, you know, everything happens for a reason. But I hope he's, you know, feeling better. I hope he's healing up. You know, I hope nothing but the best for him.
And, Alex, to that end, things didn't go all that great for the team under Ditka. And all of a sudden, Jim Haslett comes back to take over. He was a defensive coordinator there when you got in the league your rookie year. He comes back to take over as head coach. And you guys go from 3-13 in 99. To 10-6 and winning the division and a playoff game over the Rams the next year. What was the difference? What led to such a dramatic turnaround?
It was the attitude that he brought. It was the structure, and it was the accountability that he not only placed on us, but that we end up putting on ourselves. And you know, he was our defensive coordinator my rookie year with New Orleans. So, you know, I knew of him and knew of his, you know, his attitude, and, you know, he played the game. And so, you know, you got to respect that, but it was just, you know, we needed that new blood. You know, that was his first time being a head coach. And, you know, we brought in some new talent, you know, some youth. And, we took to it. And even though we had injuries that year with, our quarterback, Jeff Blake, got banged up, but then Aaron had came in and did a great job for us. Our defense, we was playing at a very high level, and, you know, we needed to, you know, to beat the Rams. You know, they were the Kansas City of that era. And, you know, with the air raid, and they had a great running back, Marshall Faulk. So he really put in, a mindset that we can do anything if we play together as a team.
And just a couple more, Alex, before we let you go. And your last season in the league, you get the opportunity to go home to Detroit to play for the Lions. Was it a dream come true, or was it hard?
It was both. It was great. I get a chance to play in front of my grandmother, my people. But at the time, you know, that was towards the end of my career. I was nicked up. I wasn't the same. And then, you know, coming to a team that was kind of young, you know, especially having Joey Harrington there. And they had something to prove. And the chemistry just wasn't the best. And I would have loved to have played there at another time, but, you know, towards the end of my career, being nicked up, and, you know, it was bittersweet. It was bittersweet for me.
Alex, now you're a motivational speaker. Talk about the folks, you know, the clients that you're working with, the things that you like to talk about, and what you want people to walk away with when you're doing a motivational speech.
Yeah. So I've done some inspirational and motivational talks, really geared on teamwork, and some of the experiences that I had playing in college and especially playing in the pros, where, you know, the demand is so high, you know, the pressure is high, but, you know, when you come together as a team, and, you know, you know your role and your expectations, and then when you can go above those expectations, still staying aligned, right? Still staying aligned with what the organization has for you. I learned a lot of good things from Coach Willie Shaw, and he was my defensive back coach when I was with the Saints. And he always, you know, he always said, talked about alignment, assignment, and adjustment. You know, make sure you know your alignment so you're not beat before the ball is even snapped. Knowing your assignment, right? Knowing your job. And then knowing that there's going to be some type of adjustment. So you got to be ahead of the game. You know, you want to be, you don't want to be reactive. And that's the same type of kind of talks that I take, you know, on the road with me when I'm talking to, you know, teams from Microsoft or Nike or the Boys and Girls Club. is kind of giving them that, you know, that same type of feel. And, you know, they enjoy it. They get a lot out of it. You know, I always have them walk away with at least three tips or bullet points that they can take with them. So it's been a lot of fun, and I enjoy what I'm doing now.
And, Alex, let our listeners know, how can they stay up to date with the great things that you're doing and find you, whether it's online or it's on social media?
Oh, sure thing. Just on social media, across all, you know, everything social media, it's Alex, at Alex Molden. And they can follow me on my, or they can check me out. My website is alexmoldenspeaks.com. And they can find out, you know, some of the things that I'm doing.
Well, Alex, it's been great having you as part of the show tonight. So many other things that we wanted to get into with you. I hope you'll come back and join us again sometime. It's been great having you tonight.
Hey, for sure, man. Anytime I can talk football, especially with some guys that have a passion for it and know what they're talking about, I have fun. I have fun.
Wow, thanks. Great. We really appreciate that very much. Thank you, Alex. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays to you and your family. We look forward to having you back soon.
Keep in touch.
Excellent. Merry Christmas. I will. Take care, guys.
Bye-bye now.
See you, Alex. That is Alex Molden. And again, came back from an absolutely devastating knee injury, Bob, and becomes an All-American, becomes a first-round draft pick, a number overall selection, and then 8 years in the league. Great player, and really so many other things I wanted to get into tonight. Hopefully we get him back soon.
Yeah, like the 2002 year with San Diego, which might have been his best year, Chris, but we'll talk about that next time. Great guest.
All right, we've got our next guest, Keith Millard, hanging on the line. We're going to get to Keith right on the other side of this quick station break.
Hear NFL legends, players, coaches, and media members from around the country sharing their insights and stories with us year-round. Here on Thursday night, Tailgate.
And now back in making his seventh appearance with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is Keith Millard. Let me remind you quickly about Keith's background. He's from Pleasanton, California, played his college ball at Washington State, where he was a Pac-10 top defensive lineman as a senior. In 1983, he won the Pac-10 Morris Award, which is given annually to the Pac-10's most outstanding offensive or defensive lineman. And last year, he was inducted into Washington State's Hall of Fame. He was a first-round draft pick, a 13th overall selection by the Minnesota Vikings back in 1984. Chose to come out and play in the USFL at that time for the Jacksonville Bulls instead. Came back to the NFL in 85 and played there from 85 to 93 for the Vikings, Seahawks, Packers, and Eagles. Was a two-time Pro Bowl selection in back-to-back years of 88 and 89. He was a first or second team All-Pro four times. And in 1989, he was the NFL's Defensive Player of the Year when he had 18 sacks. Over the course of his career, he had 70 sacks in 111 games. And after retiring, he became a coach. And he coached for the Broncos, Raiders, Bucks, and Titans. And in 2010, he was named one of the top 50 Vikings of all time and named to the All-Decade Team of the 1980s. And we are honored he is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Chris, Keith, Chris and Bob here. Thanks for coming on the show.
Hi, Keith.
What's up, guys?
How are you, Keith?
How you doing? It's been a while.
Yeah,
I know it has. You been doing all right?
I didn't realize this is my seventh time on the show. You guys might have to put me on the payroll.
Indeed.
No, it's good to be back.
Hey, Keith, as you and I were discussing yesterday, I wanted to get your thoughts. You hold the record for the most sacks in a season by a defensive tackle with 18. You got the Rams' Aaron
yep.
Donald now kind of breathing down your neck at 16 and a half with three games to go. If he breaks the record, you happy or disappointed?
Oh, I'm happy. I mean, especially to have a guy like that do it. It's been a record for a long time, and it's a defensive tackle record. It's not the overall record, but it's something that I've always been proud of. I didn't even really realize it till, you know, maybe a few years ago. It came up somehow, and it never dawned on me, but it's pretty cool either way. You know, it's kind of my claim to fame now. I'm kind of using it whenever I can, but probably after this weekend, that'll be all in the past with Aaron Donald only one and a half, really two from breaking it. But
I think the big news will be if he can break Strahan's record, and I'm rooting for him to do that as well, because this is a guy that if you watch him play, and I've watched a lot of film and watched him on TV quite a bit. This guy's unstoppable. He's constantly double teamed. They always turn the protection to him, and somehow he still breaks free and gets to that quarterback, and he's doing it pretty quick. They're not like coverage sacks where it's taking 5 seconds. He's getting there, 3 seconds, 3.5, 4 seconds. And, so it's legit. I mean, he's beating people to get there, and it's fascinating to watch him. He's got a huge skill set and unbelievable passion for the game, and it's just really fun to watch him.
And Keith, I want to get your thoughts on the Vikings so far this season. I think many of us expected them to be much better than they are at 6-6-1 right now, and they've given up 9 more points than they've scored so far this year. So really thought the defense would be a little bit better, thought the team overall would be a little bit better than just barely over 500. Your thoughts on what you're seeing from the Vikings?
I mean, it's obviously disappointing. I think, all Viking fans had higher expectations with the talent that they have. I don't know where they're struggling. I guess they're struggling a little bit with the offensive line. You can't really use any of that as an excuse to me, though, especially in the NFL. As far as talking about the offensive line, I can remember when I was coaching in Denver with Alex Gibbs as our offensive line coach under Mike Shanahan. 2001 through 2004, we never had a first-round draft pick on the offensive line. I don't think we had any draft picks on the offensive line. Alex was really big on intelligence and toughness and obviously technique, and he always got the most out of those guys no matter what. And I can also remember coaching against Denver with that same group. I mean, you look at them, and they don't look like top-of-the-line guys that you'd be worried about, but you had to be worried about them because they were tenacious, and they came after you. If they didn't, Alex Gibbs was going to put a foot up their butt. I mean, he was a little guy, but he was tough and ruthless himself and very intelligent in how he coached those guys, and he got the best out of them. And that's the league. That's what we got to do. I remember when I got into coaching, Bill Walsh told me, you can stay in this game for a long time if you can get guys to play at a higher level, no matter who they are. Get them to play at a higher level. That's the main thing. I don't know what their situation is on the offensive line. I know they've had injuries in the past and things of that nature, but they got to get it together. Now they're in transition with a new offensive coordinator. I coach with their pass offense coordinator, DeFilippo, when we were in Oakland. He was a quarterback's coach, and he was an up-and-coming, promising guy. He's smart. He's intelligent. He's had a lot of success in the league as a coach, for sure as a quarterback coach. And now they're going in a different direction. So that doesn't look good, and I'm sure it's something they got to deal with in the locker room and things of that nature when those things happen. When you lose a coach mid-season, it's a negative thing, and it can be worrisome for sure.
5 questions for Keith.
Hey, Keith, happy holidays, and thanks for joining us again. We had talked about your sacks record and just rushing the quarterback in general, and it got me thinking, Keith, about all the things needed for a defensive tackle, a guy inside to rush the quarterback, and it could be explosion, speed, athleticism, and shaking the offensive guard or whoever's blocking. There's so many things that go into it. Was there one skill more than another that you thought was the biggest important thing for rushing the quarterback? I know you have to combine a lot, Keith, but what was your main focus?
I think, some of the things that you got to have consistently is a great get off. You got to be able to beat guys quick enough off the line where they're almost like in shock. They're like rattled because of the quickness of it, and they're trying to adjust to it. But I think the main thing that you see with good rushers inside is they have a great feel for weight distribution. So when they get into guys, and they initiate their first move, whatever their plan is, they can feel a guy getting out of balance and be able to counter that. It's not something that you could teach with a lot of guys. You try to, but it's just like if you're like, for example, if you're ripping up the field and you really get off on the ball and you're making an outside move and you feel this guy oversetting you or really putting a lot of weight into you to push you outside and up past the quarterback, when you feel that, as it's happening, not after it's happening, as it's happening, you'll counter that guy while he still has all his weight trying to push you outside or up the field and throw him in the direction where his momentum's going and be able to counter back inside or whatever you're doing. And I think that's what I had. And I had an instinct to feel blockers, use their weight distribution against them and be able to get off them in time to get to the quarterback. I think you see that a lot with some of these other guys that can rush inside. They start a move, they feel something, and they use whatever that offensive lineman's doing to them against them. And it's basically just really feeling it. It's also, you know, anticipation, knowing that you could get that based on your first move. But you see that a lot with Aaron Donald. He can set up his rushes. Like, he can power you. And as soon as he feels you sitting on that power, bringing your weight back to him, he'll swim over the top and dump you on your face or, you know, spin out of it or whatever he likes to do. But it's like for every move he starts, he's always got something off it, and that's what gives offensive linemen fits. It's really hard to sustain block them when you have that kind of feel and quickness to counter. And pass rush, trust me, it's not always your first move. Most of the time, it's your counters that free you up. And when you have a good feel for weight distribution, it plays a lot into it.
I want to take you back to your rookie year, Keith. 85, of course, that was Bud Grant's. Sadly, it was his last year. The coaching staff in general, though, you had guys like Jerry Burns and Mark Trestman and Pete Carroll. I just wanted to get your overall impression of that coaching staff in general. Did a guy like Carroll have the same enthusiasm back then as he does now?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. That guy is full of piss and vinegar and has more energy than anybody I've ever seen. Not just on the football field, in meeting rooms, when he's doing bed check, whatever he's doing, eating lunch. I mean, this guy is high octane in his approach to coaching. And you have to be. You got to keep guys up. But in 85, we had a really good coaching staff. We had John Michaels, our offensive line coach, who's been there. You know, from the 60s when the team started. Jerry Burns has been there, came over from Green Bay with Vince Lombardi. He's a great coach. We had Monty Kiffin as our linebacker coach. Floyd Peters was probably one of the best defensive coordinators in the NFL at that time. We were always a top five defense. I think we were number one 3 out of the 5 years or 6 years that I was healthy, but we were always top 10, top five when he took over. We absolutely had some great coaches, especially on our defense.
And Keith, as a guy who played in the USFL for the Jacksonville Bulls, yeah, I want to get your thoughts on the American Alliance of Football that's set to kick off this February, the new spring league. What are your thoughts? Do you think they've got what they need to do in order to actually make this one successful when so many others have failed?
You know, I tell you, I hope so, because in my opinion, we need some type of feeder league for the NFL to give these guys a little bit more development. Because some guys, when they come out, whether they're coming out of smaller schools or whatever the situation is, they're not fully developed. They have the size, speed, all that, but they're not fully developed. Could use these leagues to enhance their ability and get more experience. And hopefully learn from a coach that, you know, that could give them that pro experience. I don't know what kind of coaches they're going to have. And I don't know if this league will last. I mean, there's been 1,000 leagues that have tried, and some of them had great ideas and great potential, you know, good plan to, you know, start these leagues up. I don't know if the fans want it. I think if they could really focus on it being a feeder league like minor league baseball, which is pretty popular, you know, and maybe if the NFL would back it. That's the problem, is they've got to get the NFL to back it, and then the fans, I think, will take it more seriously, because it's not just getting the coaches or the former players or whoever it is to start these leagues. They've done that before, and they haven't worked. The bottom line is, to me, unless you have the NFL stamp on it, it's really hard to make it.
Keith, one more before we let you go. And speaking of your time in the USFL with the Bulls, if you go back and look at the roster that you guys had, you had former Browns quarterback Brian Sipe on that team. You had a couple of Heisman Trophy winners in Mike Rozier and Archie Griffin. Plus, you had Von Johnson on the defense with you. Talk about what it was like, you know, leaving Washington State and stepping onto a team that had those guys.
Yeah, that's a good question. You know, going into the USFL, I really didn't want to play in the USFL. My dream was always to play in the NFL, and all the players that I looked up to growing up through high school and even younger in college, and wanting to play with those guys, the best of the best. So I didn't know what my expectations were going to be. I really didn't know how to look at it going into the USFL. But what legitimized it for me was Brian Sipe was there. And then, obviously, Von Johnson was there, who was another big, talented guy coming out of college. And then when you got the Heisman Trophy winner there, one of them's on our team, and one of them's playing for the Generals, you know, it kind of gave me the idea, you know what, maybe this is a little bit more legit than, you know, that I'm really seeing it right now. So I gave it a chance, and I'm glad I did, because it was a good league. We had a lot of players from that league that went back to the NFL or went to the NFL from that league that ended up being Hall of Famers, all pros, big-time contributors. I mean, there's a huge list of guys from that league that played in the NFL when that league folded that had great careers in the NFL. You know, Reggie White, Gary Zimmerman, Mike Rozier, you know, the list goes on with some of these guys. Herschel Walker, I mean, I could go on and on about all the guys that played in that league. I just think when we started to go head-to-head with the NFL, and when Trump took over, well, when Trump got in the league, you know, he had a lot of money, and a lot of these owners were just making it, and they couldn't afford to do the things that Trump really wanted to do with the league, and it just went belly up. But to me, it was legitimate. Going straight from the USFL to the NFL, to an NFL camp, it really didn't seem any different to me. I mean, I had 11 sacks my rookie year and only started 5 games in 85 with the Vikings. And I had 12 in the USFL. And I can tell you right now, it was just as hard getting them. I mean, the linemen in that league were legit for sure.
Keith, before we let you go, remind our listeners how they can stay up to date with what you're doing over social media.
So I'm basically on Twitter. That's kind of where I stay in touch with my fans, especially Viking fans. But it's at Keith J. Millard 75. That's my address. And anytime you want to reach out and say hello, I'd appreciate it if you did.
Great stuff. Keith, you're fantastic. We can't thank you enough for continuing to come back now 7 times on the show. We're already looking forward to number 8. I hope that's real soon.
Thanks, fellas. I'll be expecting that check in the mail.
Indeed.
Thanks.
Merry
Keith.
Christmas. Happy holidays to you and your family.
Merry
Keith,
Christmas,
take care.
Guys.
Yep. All right.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
That's the great Keith Millard. Always so much fun with Keith. We've got our next guest, Don Beebe, hanging on the line. We'll get to Don on the other side of this quick station break.
Thursday Night Tailgate, where the spotlight is always on the positive. Tune in Thursday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time to hear your favorite NFL legends, players, and coaches sharing their stories. Now back to Chris and Bob.
I wouldn't joke about anything else that happened to you tonight.
And now back with us here on Thursday Night Tailgate is former wide receiver Don Beebe. Let me remind you about Don's background. He is from Aurora, Illinois, and he attended Caneland High School up in Maple Park, Illinois, where he was a 3-sport star, lettering in track, basketball, and football. Started out his college career at Western Illinois University, later transferred over to Chadron State College in Nebraska, where he ran track and played football. Despite only being there for 1 year, he became the first person in school history to score a touchdown in every game. Danny Woodhead would later tie that record. He'd also be the first to score 5 touchdowns in a game. He set the single season record for the most touchdowns with 15, most points with 90, and most all-purpose yards with nearly 1,700. In track, he set an NAIA District 11 record in the 60-yard dash. The Omaha Herald named him the 1989 State College Athlete of the Year, and he was inducted into the Chadron State Athletic Hall of Fame back in 2000, and they renovated their football stadium and named it in his honor. He was invited to the combine, where he ran a 4.440, the fastest among the wide receivers that year, and was a third-round draft pick by the Buffalo Bills in 1989. Played in the league from 89 to 97 for the Bills, Panthers, and the Packers, and he was a part of the Packers Super Bowl 31 championship team, and we are delighted he is back with us again tonight here on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Don, Chris, and Bob, thanks for coming back on the show.
Hey, guys, how you doing?
Oh, we're fantastic, thank you. How are you?
Good. I'm doing great, man. Just took a head football coaching job at Aurora University 3-4 weeks ago, and my head is spinning.
Great.
I was going to ask you. Talk about the job. I'm delighted to read that.
Well, it's a different animal, I'll tell you that. So coaching high school ball for 14 years and going into the college ranks, which I knew I wanted to do once I became an empty nester. Now our last child is a senior in high school, going to be going to Grand Valley State to play volleyball. And I took this head job at Aurora University. I love every second of it. And we're just now in the process of recruiting kids, and that's a full-time job now.
No doubt. So talk about, you know, all of a sudden now you're a head college football coach, right? Life changes. It's certainly, I'm sure, a lot different than what you had to deal with in high school. So talk about, you know, having to go through and finding recruits and being a part of that process. And oh, by the way, you know, trying to stay within the NCAA rules, which I think is probably thicker than War and Peace, to make sure you're not violating anything. Talk about the challenges with all of that.
Yeah, you gotta certainly be up to speed on the rules, because they change, you know, quite often. But you know, it's you just learn what you're supposed to do. And my biggest thing now is I got to get out there and talk to kids. I know I wanted to be a big part of that. You know, because initially you gotta get players. I mean, every coach would tell you, you know, you win with good players. Coaches don't win, players do. And so we gotta go out there, and we're hitting it running now. I get at Division III at this school that I'm at, Aurora University, I get 4 full-time guys. So we got 5 guys out hitting the pavement all over the Chicago area, all over the country. And I'm making calls. As soon as I get off this call, I got about 2 or 3 more calls to talk to with some recruits. So I'm enjoying it. I really do. I love being an impact on young men, and football is just my avenue to be able to do that.
And talk about your coaching staff that you're assembling. I imagine you know, these kids are going to be very fortunate, not only get to play for you, but the other coaches you're putting together.
Yeah, we all staff we got has been great. Started with my inner circle, which was Mike Tissot. He played a couple years with the Buffalo Bills. He had a short stint there back in, how was it, early 2000, somewhere around there. He was the first athlete that I actually trained at House of Speed, believe it or not. And I started House of Speed in 1998. And he was our first athlete that we started training, and he landed up getting a shot at with the Buffalo Bills. You know, it was a short stint, but he's just a great teacher. So he's the first guy I called and hired on. And then, you know, from there I just went out and got, you know, some quality men. I mean, the first thing that I learned from Coach Levy and guys like Bill Polian, you know, character counts. And the first thing you got to have in your staff is guys that are full, you know, the men of character. And then we got to go out and get kids that are, you know, young men of character. And then you go to the next things, and, you know, as far as the talent and everything like that. But if he doesn't have character first, you know, probably not the guy we're looking for.
And Don, you mentioned Bill Polian, and we were just talking with Keith Millard about the new Spring League. That Bill Polian is right at the top, you know, of the, you know, important people putting that league together. Wanted to get your thoughts on that league. And do you think that having a guy like Polian at the head of that it's got an opportunity to be successful where all the others have failed.
Well, I got to say this. Of all the men I've ever met in my life, if he would certainly be on that very, very, very short list of guys that I would say could get this done. That's a football man now. He understands what it takes. He's a professional. And he's a go-getter. So he's extremely sharp. He's put a lot of, you know, he's got a lot of really big name coaches, you know, former players, former NFL coaches that are coaching at these. I think there's 8 teams, I believe it is.
Right.
You know, some of them are my friends. I mean, I've been talking to him. I researched it to you know, go coach at that deal. You know, obviously I decided on the Royal University thing, but I think it's a great thing. You know, there's a lot of guys that just get cut that are really, really good players, you know, and to be able to have an opportunity to go into this, like, it's almost like a farm system, you know, like baseball has. Obviously, somehow, some way, I believe that they're going to have to get the NFL behind it, you know, because all the other ones did folded because, you know, you can't compete against the NFL. I mean, it's just too big of a fish. So if they can get the NFL, obviously they got a lot of NFL people, you know, former coaches and obviously, you know, Bill and people like that. They actually, to me, to be honest with you, I think they need 2 or 3 leagues like this. You know, several leagues that gives these guys opportunities, you know, to just showcase their abilities. Obviously you're going to have to do it in the off seasons of the NFL because you're never going to get any TV ratings, but, I think it's great. I'm really excited for the Alliance League.
Bob, questions for Don?
It's always great having you on, Don, especially this time of the year, talking to a former Buffalo Bill with the weather getting a little colder here in the Northeast. Don, I mean, you grew up, obviously, in the Midwest, played college ball there, but there's nothing quite like Buffalo. For anybody that has spent time up there, it's almost inexplicable sometimes, Don. And for a guy like yourself that actually didn't start every game, but obviously played a lot. I mean, did you ever get, quote-unquote, used to that kind of weather?
Yeah. I don't think you ever get used to extreme heat or extreme cold.
Right.
You know, I think you get acclimated to a certain degree. I mean, I just, you know, for example, when the Raiders would come into town, you know, I just remember the championship game when they came into town and we just smoked them 51-3. I mean, they didn't even want to come out of the locker room, you know. So it was something where, and it was extreme cold that day. So we were a little more acclimated to it, but it still wasn't great for us either, but it was really bad for them. So I just think that, you know, weather-wise, Marv used to say all the time, you know, when it's horrible for them, it's just right for us, you know. And so that was kind of our mentality with the weather. You know, Miami hated coming up to Buffalo in December and January, and it was a huge advantage for us because just from the mental standpoint. And that's one of the things I teach kids too, coaching. Just, you know, I use a lot of Marvism is what we call it. If you think it's bad, it's a lot worse. If you think it's fine, you're way ahead of the game.
And Don, we've talked about it before. You had a chance to play with two of the great quarterbacks in history when you come down to it, Jim Kelly, Brett mm-hmm. Favre, a good friend of mine tonight, Mike. He got a hold of me and wanted me to mention your 200-yard game for those 1996 Packers. But compare those two quarterbacks. They were both known, obviously, Don, for their toughness. But compare them, besides the toughness, what about the two?
Obviously, they have a lot of similarities between the two guys. I mean, their personalities during the course of the game were very similar, extremely competitive guys, fun-loving guys. Practical joking guys, didn't take a whole lot of things too serious guys. I think that just from an athletic standpoint, I think that the only separating factors would have been Brett liked to make more plays outside the pocket, whereas Jim was more of a pocket passer. And I tell you, you know, just both great individuals. You know, the thing about Jim Kelly, I actually was talking with him today. We were texting back and forth and he's just, he is probably, I mean, he was certainly one of the most loyal people I've ever met in my life. I mean, when I would call Jim and needed Jim to do something or sign, whatever, you know, and boy, Jim would be there in a heartbeat and help you out. He's very unique in that area. And you know, the man's beat cancer 3 times. I mean, it's just he has an amazing story. And if you've never heard Jim Kelly's story, boy, you got to bring him in and have him speak, because he's touched a lot of people's lives.
Don, I want to stay on the subject of the Bills and get your thoughts on what you're seeing from them this year. You know, the team that made the playoffs for the first time in 17 years last year, and I think going into this year, a lot of hopes for Bills fans, and it just hasn't worked out, I think, the way we all sort of thought it would, or at least build off of what they had last year. Your thoughts on what you've seen so far?
Yeah, you know, it seems like both my teams are in a little bit of disarray right now. You know, yeah, Josh is just young. You know, I think he is going to be a great quarterback. I really do. He's just, you know, I mean, look at all the great quarterbacks that have played, Hall of Fame guys, and then go back to their rookie years. And they were just, most of them, not very good. I mean, Marino might be the exception to that rule, but all the other ones from, you know, Aikman and Elway, and, I mean, obviously Jim started in the USFL, so, but it's going to be ugly. Typically for a young guy, give this guy some time, put some players around him. You know, I mean, the quarterback's only as good as the guys in front of him. And, you know, so I just hope Buffalo can turn around and get back to what they used to be. I mean, it's, man, there's no fans anywhere that deserve a championship more than those people in Western New York. And one day they're going to get it. And boy, I just hope I'm there in the stadium, and a lot of those guys from those 90 teams come back and root those guys on to win a Super Bowl, man. That would be sweet to be a part of.
Don, just a couple more before we let you go. And was curious, so with all the guys that you lined up against on the opposite line of the, you know, opposite sides of the line of scrimmage, all the defensive backs that you went against, you know, were there guys that talked a lot, tried to intimidate you, get in your head? Who are the guys that you sort of shook your head and go, you know, okay, man?
Well, the toughest defensive back I ever went against was Dale Carter. Dale Carter had the longest arms. He could run. He's extremely athletic. You know, and he was just tough. I think the biggest trash talker, and it was all in jest and it was fun. The first time I ever stepped on a football field, believe it or not, was in the Astrodome against the Oilers my rookie year. So we're down there. It's a nationally televised game, Saturday afternoon game, 1989, and Chris Dishman is guarding me. So I'm running up the line of scrimmage. It's a run play, and Chris is talking trash, and he's like, "All right, white boy," he says, "I hear you can run. Let's see it, man." And I was like, "I'm scared to death." All right, you know. So, and you know, and he was just doing it fun. He wasn't being a jerk about it. So the next time I get coming out, I'm supposed to do a post corner on that side of the ball, and Chris is coming up talking trash again. And before I left the huddle, Jim Kelly, you know, Jim goes, "Hey, Beeps," he says, "if Dishman's pressed, I'm throwing it to you. Go deep." I'm like, oh, boy, here we go, you know. So I go out there, and sure enough, he's pressed on me, and he's talking trash and calling me all this and everything like that, trying to take me out of my game, and I beat him for a 63-yard touchdown. So the first pass that ever went my way was a 63-yard bomb. And I you should have seen me. You need to Google it and watch this, because I skipped like a girl. I didn't even know what to do, you know. You know, I didn't know what an end zone was in the NFL. So I get back out, and the whole funny thing about the whole story was I get back out there, and the next third down, and it's a run play, and I'm running up the line of scrimmage, and Dishman comes up right in my face, and he backs up about 8 steps. He says, "Dang, white boy can run, man." So it was pretty funny. Chris might not remember the story, but I do, because I was scared to death of him. But
well, it's funny that you mentioned that, because Dish is on the show with us next week. So we'll find out if he remembers that story.
Let's see if he remembers that. He'll remember the play. He probably won't remember the trash talking, but that was funny.
Yeah, last one, Don. Your last year in the league was in 97. You still played in 10 games, and of course that year before, as we mentioned, you had the 200-yard game. Do you think you went out on your own terms, Don? Were you ready for retirement? I mean, is it a question of losing a step? What was the deal with you in 97? You still, to me, were playing at a pretty high level.
Yeah, it was kind of a tough ending for me, to be honest with you. I was, you know, I loved the Packers and going to the Super Bowl 31 and winning it, and then 32 was a tough year. You know, I battled with some injuries, and And I still have my speed. I mean, when I went to the Green Bay Packers at 31 years old, I ran a 4.25.
Wow.
At the Don Hunsett Center, they were doing a pro day there, and so I could still run. And then that 32 year Super Bowl 32 year 97, you know, I had a hamstring issue, and it became political. It seemed like, and then I got myself ready, and I was ready to go and everything like that. And Tuesday, we're in San Diego. Tuesday, I was practicing all the week before that. And Tuesday we get there, and Mike Holmgren pulled me aside, and he just said, you know, Don, we're not going to dress you. And I was like, I was devastated. I was like, why? You know, so he told me they wanted to activate a guy by the name of Ronnie Anderson, who they had cut 2 weeks after the season was over. And so it was a little disheartening for me, and it kind of just said, you know, I think it took that, really. And I don't blame anybody. I just think it took that for me to just steal that thunder. And, you know, I was going to go to Oakland, and, you know, when John Gruden was there, and maybe try to work out a deal and sign another year or two with the Raiders. But I decided at that time, I had three kids. I got four now, but I decided, you know what, I think I'm just going to hang it up. I had a great career, loved every minute of it. And it was, I think it took something like that from the business side of things to just kind of just to tell me that it was time to hang up the cleats. So I got no qualms about it. I got a son that's playing in the NFL now with the Minnesota Vikings, so I'm enjoying his career and loving every minute of that as a father and seeing the different side of what my dad had to go through. And I'll be honest, it's a whole lot more nerve-wracking as a parent than it was a player, that's for sure. But I'm enjoying his career right now.
Don, before we let you go, let our listeners know, and certainly all the people around Chicago, how they can follow you on Twitter and stay up to date with all the great things that you're doing. And particularly now as you move on as the head coach at Aurora University.
Yeah, the Don Beebe NFL Twitter, but the best way actually is to DonBeebe.com. Just go to DonBeebe.com, and that's basically where, you know, I do a lot of public speaking around the country. I enjoy that. That's something that they like to me to come into a different business venue or a church or wherever. You know, that's the best way to get a hold of me, guys, and I appreciate you having me on. It's always good to be on your guys' show.
We appreciate it very much, Don. Thanks for taking time out of your night to join us. We hope you'll do it again soon. And in between now and then, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays to you and your family.
Yeah, thanks, Bob and Chris. I appreciate it. Merry Christmas to you guys, too.
Good luck. Good luck, Don.
Thank you.
Take care, Don. Good luck.
All right. Bye-bye.
That's the great Don Beebe. And I tell you what, Bob, you want to talk about a group of kids about to really get a great coach. Those that end up at Aurora University are going to be a group of lucky kids.
You're not kidding, especially the wide receivers, Chris. Can you imagine? If I had a kid, a wide receiver, I'm going to send him there, because Beebe, can you imagine, Chris, 31 years old, a 4.25?
Right?
Seriously? But you can look it up, folks. As they say, that's incredible. But, yeah, he had speed, man. I remember the Buffalo games, the 1 o'clock games here in the Northeast. What fun watching that guy run.
Yeah, no kidding. And, you know, tough as nails, too. And, you know, we've had Felix Wright on the show a handful of times, defensive back for the Cleveland Browns. And if you haven't seen the hit that he lays on Don, where he sort of takes Don's legs out from underneath him as Don is, you know, jumping for a pass and flips him over, and Don almost straight down on his head, and it bounces up, you know, on his head, bounces off the turf, you know, as if he was an arrow or something. A devastating hit, but Don bounced right back up and kept on going. So a tough guy, a fast guy, and just a wonderful guy, and we really enjoy him, and we look forward to getting him back on the show again soon. All right, folks, when Bob and I come back, we'll be turning on the Thursday Night Tailgate Spotlight on the positive. Hear which players are out there doing great things in their communities. We'll do that. We'll wrap up the show all on the other sides of these words from our friends at the Salt Creek Golf Retreat and DP Quality Foods from our announcer, Joe Lajanusa.
If you're looking for a great place for your annual golf outing, a weekend golf getaway, or just a round of golf with your buddy, then Salt Creek Golf Retreat is just what you're looking for. Centrally located in Nashville, Indiana, just south of Indianapolis and west of Cincinnati, this challenging but fair 18-hole golf course appeals to all skill levels, and its scenic views of rolling hills and tree-lined fairways are sure to make golfing memories for years to come. A
owned and operated by former Purdue and New York Giants fullback Randy Manier, Salt Creek Golf Retreat offers stay-and-play packages that include golf and a fully furnished one- or two-bedroom condo. After your round, be sure to stop by the 19th Hole Sports Bar and Restaurant for great food, fun, and drinks. Randy and his staff will treat you like family. For more information, log on to saltcreekgolf.com. That's saltcreekgolf.com. Or give them a call at 812-558-5944. Salt Creek Golf Retreat. Start making your golfing memories today. Most folks are familiar with Dan Pastorini's accomplishments on the football field or in race cars. But what most don't know? Dan's family background in the restaurant business. For 37 years, Dan's parents, Dante and Dorothy, owned and operated Pastorini's Longhorn Restaurant. So the Pastorini family has a long history of making great-tasting food from family recipes. Dan and his partners want to bring some of that to you with their Texas-style rub, Texas-style hickory rub, and their garlic and herb seasoning. First introduced back in 2011, Dan's Texas-style rub immediately began winning awards, taking home the first place trophy for best ribs at the Pasadena Livestock Show and Barbecue Cook-Off. They did it again at the 2012 Texas Ranger Wounded Warrior Cook-Off, and the awards just keep on coming. Check out Dan's line of spices online at dpqualityfoods.com. That's dpqualityfoods.com. And take what you put on the grill to a whole new level.
Thursday Night Tailgate, where the spotlight is always on the positive. Tune in Thursday night from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time to hear your favorite NFL legends, players, and coaches sharing their stories. Now back to Chris and Bob.
I wouldn't joke about anything else that happened to you tonight.
We are back here on Thursday Night Tailgate, and we're turning on our spotlight on the positive. Bob, who are you spotlighting this week?
That's a feel-good story again, Chris, and my favorite part of the show. This is a great time of the year, Chris. As you know, we mentioned last week, all the new nominees for the NFL Man of the Year have come out, and hopefully we can get to all 30. We will get to all 30 of these guys at some point over the next year. But the Rams nominee, Chris, this year, Andrew Whitworth. Andrew Whitworth is a left tackle, Chris, that's been around the league a long time, spent most of his career in Cincinnati. This is his second year with the Rams, a very talented player, very solid, dependable player. But what he does off the field is incredible, Chris. I mean, since he got to L.A., he automatically became pretty much a team leader in the locker room, and especially by doing the things he does off the field. I mean, this year, Chris, he's been helping introduce the Rams Night for Wishes, which they do on the behalf of the Make-A-Wish Foundation. He serves as the host, and what's great about it, he gets his teammates involved on a big thing like that, too. And also does a lot with veterans, Chris, homeless veterans. He's a good friend of Nate Boyer, you know, one of the MVP's co-founders. That's the Emerging Vets and Players. And this month he's going to, with Boyer, he's going to go visit the Hollywood Veterans Center. That's a homeless shelter in L.A. And he also does tons of things around the holidays, Chris, at other schools in that area in L.A. The guy buys 50 tickets out of his own pocket for every home game, donates them to local charities to give out. He's got his own foundation, Chris. It's called the Big Wit 77 Foundation. That's back in his home state of Louisiana. And that does a lot of different things, especially for high school seniors. He has another thing called Open Arms, which part of the foundation offers financial assistance to people down there that are adopting. And, you know, he does a lot of wish list things, and he goes to speak at schools. And, again, I can go on, and that's why he's a nominee, Chris. And we cannot talk about this guy enough, and I'm sure his name will come up again, but kudos this week, L.A. Rams left tackle Andrew Whitworth. We salute you.
Absolutely we do. That guy is doing tremendous stuff, Bob, so that's a great story. I'm putting my spotlight on Chiefs tackle Eric Fisher tonight, Bob. And the reason is going to be something near and dear to your heart. Last Friday, Fisher, plus people from a couple of organizations, Chain of Hope, which is an organization focused on alleviating the suffering of abused and neglected animals within Kansas City, plus folks from the Rescue Project and Spay and Neuter of Kansas City. All three organizations met up with Fisher at Arrowhead Stadium, and he had a year-long campaign going on to raise funds to help support all three of them. And he pledged to match however much they were able to raise, up to $50,000. Well, the three organizations raised $60,000, so we went ahead and matched that. So $120,000 was raised to split amongst those three groups. And the campaign is called Fishing for a Mission. And the goal for all three groups is to rescue animals from being out in the cold this time of year and get them into a place where they have food and shelter. And they don't always have the funds that they need to do those sorts of things, which is why Fisher got involved, something near and dear to his heart, because he doesn't like to see animals out there in the cold winter trying to, you know, fend for themselves, if you will, or out wandering in the cold. So he's trying to help those organizations. Plus, the organizations also provide dog houses to people when they see a dog out roaming in a neighborhood, or maybe just out being, you know, behind a fence and just sort of roaming around out there throughout the course of the day. They want to be able to give the families that have those dogs a dog house so the dog has a place to go and, you know, at least get out of the weather, if you will. So, and then they also offer low-cost spay and neuter services. So Eric Fisher is out there in the cold himself. He's out there just amongst all of the other volunteers. It's not a guy that, you know, could have just stroked a check and like, you know, hey, you raised $60,000. Hey, here's your $60,000. We're good. No, he's out there with the volunteers on weekends, driving neighborhoods, checking out, you know, where there are opportunities to help these animals so that they can stay, again, warm and fed. So kudos to Eric Fisher, Bob, for making a positive impact on the lives of dogs in and around the Kansas City area.
Thanks for bringing that up, Chris. That's a hero to me. And it's a reason, you know, efforts by guys like him are reasons why there are laws being put on the books for that kind of thing, leaving pets out in the cold, which should have happened a long time ago. But it's a guy like that pounding the pavement, doing what he does. Again, that's a true hero, Chris. He doesn't have to do that. There's other organizations he could be around, but he knows the financial constraints in that business and how tough it is and how big of a problem it is. And kudos for him to stepping on board.
Yeah, absolutely. And Bob, I want to give you the opportunity. You speak about heroes. You're out there working with heroes every weekend. You're a hero, and the folks that you're working with to try to, you know, with rescue dogs and to try to find homes for dogs that, you know, are being trucked from down south all the way up to the Connecticut area to try to find good homes. You know, put in a plug for the folks that you're working with.
Yeah, Chris, I just try to do my part. You know, I mean, I've always been a pet owner and lover, and I know the problems they face. And I'll be out there again Saturday, the next two Saturdays. He'll be making trips up here from the deep south up to Connecticut to drop off animals that have been adopted beforehand, and to see their owners meet their dogs for the first time, Chris. I can't put it into words, the tears and just pure joy that comes out every weekend up this way. But yeah, that's a transport company that I volunteer with, rescueroadtrips.com. If people are looking to save a dog in the south, you go to that website, rescueroadtrips.com. You look at the companies that he deals with, and then you make the arrangements to have a dog that's already been vetted, et cetera, to get their new home up here in New England. It's just a fascinating business and very rewarding.
Kudos to you, Bob. Great stuff that you're doing with that organization. All right, my friend, time for us to put a bow on this episode of Thursday Night Tailgate. We certainly want to send our sincere thanks out to Lynn Kane, Tony Collins, Alex Molden, Keith Millard, and Don Beebe for joining us. And Bob, like I always say, great getting to spend my Thursday nights doing this show with you.
You too, Chris. Those guys were a lot of fun, you know, some old friends and a new one too. But we'll do it again next week. And Chris Dish is one of our guys, right?
That's right. So next week, we'll lead off the show with our good friend and NFL stats guru, Russell Baxter, plus Julie Vaught, who is working with Russell at Pro Football Guru. So they'll come on as a tandem and join us. Great. To start the show. And then Chris Dishman will be back with us. So looking forward to seeing if he remembers the story of, about Don Beebe. Another great friend and former Bucs Super Bowl champion center and current special teams and running backs coach. We talk a lot about the American Alliance of Football. Well, one of the new coaches for the Orlando Apollos in that league is Todd Washington. T. Wash has been a wonderful friend. It's been a while since we've got to have him on the show. So looking forward to catching up with Todd. And then author Ron Lippick, you know, Ron's been on the show a handful of times. He's got that. He's an author of the book called Steelers Takeaways. He's going to join us. So we'll talk more about some hopefully happier memories. I'm not expecting to have too many to talk about next week with the Steelers coming off the game with the Patriots. But, you know, hope springs eternal. Maybe we all get lucky all by saying, you know, Steeler Nation and Ron, that we have a story there. Plus, I get to talk about more of the interviews that he has done with former Steelers as well. Plus, of course, Tony Collins will join us for our five-star picks of the week. So really looking forward to next week's show. Want to let you know how you guys can follow us on social media. Please go to our Facebook page, Thursday Night Tailgate. Give us a like. That's very important to us. Plus, both Bob and I have our own Facebook pages as well. Please check out our website, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. On there, you'll be able to see who some of our future guests are going to be. Plus, we link back to our page over on Podbean. I can't thank those guys enough for featuring us front and center and their NFL fan section. So really appreciate Podbean for doing that for us. Check us out there. You can go to podbean.com, podbean.thursdaynighttailgate.com, I should say, to check us out over there. Plus download the Podbean app and you can listen to us anywhere you go on your smartphone. On Twitter, you can find me at CT Mascaro. Bob is at Bob_Lazzari. The show is at TNT Podcast. Bob, take us home, my friend.
Thank you, Chris, and good luck to those Steelers, brother. You're going to need it, I think. So we want to give a good shout-out to our terrific announcer, Joe Lajanusa, for the awesome job he always does with our intro and ads. We want to also give a shout-out to Kyle Turley and the Kyle Turley Band for the upcoming outro music you'll hear. And on behalf of myself and Chris, we thank everyone tonight for listening. We appreciate you the very most. Until next week, good night, Kevin. Good night, Terry. We miss you guys.